Welcome, Nicole, and I want to start with the basics. What exactly is fracking and why is it a potential public health concern?
Sure, thank you for having me. Fracking, or hydraulic fracturing, is a term we use to describe this broader process of extracting oil and natural gas from these deep rock formations that have only recently become available to us due to some advances in drilling technologies. So in this process, a well is drilled a mile or two below ground and then turned and drilled horizontally directly into this very low porous, low permeable rock. Then millions of gallons of water, chemical additives, and sand are pumped down into the well under extraordinarily high pressure, which breaks open the rock and liberates oil and gas trapped within. So the oil and gas flows up the well, and along with it also comes some of the injection fluids that were pumped down in the first place, as well as some brine water that was also trapped within the rock. And that water mobilizes crustal elements like heavy metals, like lead and arsenic, and naturally occurring radioactive materials. So all of this leads to 7 to 14 million gallons of wastewater being generated per each well. And that waste must be managed and properly disposed of.
Amazing technology to harvest fossil fuels, possibly helping us avoid coal, which is the worst fossil fuel. People would say, well, it's a necessary evil. Why is it a public health concern?
Yes, well, I'm glad you brought up that question of climate change, because natural gas has been sort of touted as this bridge fuel that's more climate friendly compared to coal, because when you burn it, you do release lower levels of carbon dioxide and other fossil fuels. However, there's a very active area of research suggesting that the methane in the natural gas, which is a potent greenhouse gas, leaks, and there are fugitive emissions of methane. So some researchers are arguing that those methane emissions may actually offset the potential benefit to climate change. And then with respect to other public health concerns, there have been many that have been raised with regard to this industry, including water contamination, the potential for air pollution, seismic activity such as these micro earthquakes in areas that rarely see earthquakes, as well as, perhaps social disruption of community cohesion, damage to roadway infrastructure. So there have been a number of concerns raised. On the flip side, I should point out that proponents of this technology do point to the potential for local economic stimulation, lower fuel prices, and some other benefits such as those.
So I found it fascinating to read your recent paper about an increase in sexually transmitted infections associated with proximity to fracking sites. And could you share your speculations with our audience as to why that might have been the case?
Our recent publication observed a 20% increase in the rate of both chlamydia and gonorrhea in counties with high drilling activity compared to those with no fracking whatsoever. And we hypothesize that this is because this industry requires an influx of specialized workers to meet the labor demands of these drilling rigs. And these workers are commonly housed in work camps, which include a lot of young males without their families or single, few ties to the community, disposable income, leading to this sort of hyper-masculinized culture that can lead to an increase in sexual partners and therefore increase the rate of these STIs in the community.
Well, makes a lot of sense. In places with heavy fracking activity, I know you've been working in the state of Ohio. What would you say are some of your most intriguing research findings to date?
One study I'd like to tell you about is related to an environmental justice issue. There's a tremendous amount of waste that is generated, wastewater generated from these operations, 7 to 14 million gallons of wastewater per well, and they commonly contain toxic and radioactive materials. So in Ohio, we observed that the disposal sites for this wastewater were disproportionately placed in communities of lower income.
Well, that's a recurring theme. Less politically empowered people are often taken advantage of in our system, and it's good that you're unearthing that that element of unfairness and, as you say, social justice. What are your long-term research goals in this pretty much new field?
My vision is to investigate the multiple public health dimensions of this new industry. So whether it be environmental justice, the STIs, the chemicals, I'd like to take this approach where I examine all the different factors and look at the potential impacts, if there are any, of this industry. One project I'm very interested in is related to the potential for water contamination. So I'm leading an interdisciplinary effort to investigate whether people who live near these sites do in fact have increased potential for water contamination, and whether there are increases in adverse birth outcomes like low birth weight or preterm birth. And I think to do this really well requires a multidisciplinary approach, which is why I've built a team of investigators from multiple departments here at the School of Public Health, as well as collaborations across the Yale campus, including engineers and hydrogeologists. And I think by having all of these disciplines come together, we can really advance understanding of the impact potential of this industry and provide really high quality critical research for policymakers and other scientists.
Mm-hmm. Well, this has been just so interesting for me, and I know it will be for our audience. We're just very pleased that you're here in the School of Public Health and want to support this incredibly important work, innovative, potentially high-impact work, as much as we can. And so thanks for joining us.
Thank you. It's been my pleasure.